ladies and gentlemen, first of all, I would like to give my heartfelt thanks to the organizers of this conference. In the next few 2 hours, I would like to show you many pictures of artifacts from all over the world. Many of them, we could do tests on them, and I can give you more detailed informations, but many of these artifacts I show you, I have no really explanation. That's why they are called O-parts or out-of-place artifacts, and you might be able to find your own solution. So starting with the next few pictures are some scans. 3 years ago, I got an invitation to the second international conference in Visoko by Dr. Samos Manakic, and when I saw the list of the speakers, I was surprised because most of them high-ranking scientists. So a few months before, I started a cooperation with a very good friend of mine in Germany who invented a new technology. A technology which makes us able to make scans through the earth down even up to 6,000 meters. And I asked my friend if he can do me a favor and make me a scan over the Sun pyramid. And when we showed this scan, it showed us that there is a tunnel system inside the Sun pyramid, which has a spiral form up, and a Serbian engineer and scientist told me that that might be one of the reasons why the pyramid creates a very strong energy going up on top of the pyramid. So this time I asked my friend also if he can do me a scan over the moon pyramid, but he was so busy so he could do me just the first pre-scan, but it shows also already that there is a tunnel system inside the moon pyramid. Here you see our scan from from 3 years ago. It shows us from 5 meters down to the lowest tunnel, which is in the deepness of approximately 400 meters. And as you heard before from Samos Manakic, the first reading by the lady Nancy was saying that there is a room inside the center of the pyramid. We did not know about this reading, but we found out that in 150 meters here, there is one room inside with four entrances. So when I got the final scan, for me it was definitely and 100% sure that the Sun pyramid is a pyramid. This time we found another huge, very big tunnel which is connecting here with the Sun pyramid, which is going up this way, cross underground under the river here, and joining here the moon pyramid, but joining also part of the other pyramids. You would not believe it, but this tunnel is 170 meters deep underground. There are many other tunnels which are not so deep. This is a closer-up from the scan of the Sun pyramid here, and you see here part of the Ravne labyrinth. Here are the main tunnels of the Ravne labyrinth, because there are hundreds of tunnels. It would be quite impossible to scan all in precise style, but you can see that there is so much more under the earth of Visoko. And I told yesterday to Samos Manakic, I said, "Sam, congratulations, I think you are busy the next 50 years at least." And what I cannot understand is that Visoko and the government from Bosnia and Herzegovina is not accepting this really worldwide sensation. And we should learn, and they should help and assist him, which many countries, people from all over the world, they are doing already, because I'm quite sure this will be one or even the most important archaeological discovery of history. Here you can see this deep underground tunnel, another one, and here you see a big, big underground room, very deep under the earth. The question is, who was able to make such a long tunnel, 170 meters under the ground level? And for what purpose? This is the question. Here you have the first pre-scan of the moon pyramid. You can see that there starts already also a kind of tunnel system in 50 meters under the ground level. Here we have another chamber also in the center of the moon pyramid, which is 220 meters deep. And what we could detect with this new technology is in this chamber there are bones. So it would be very, very interesting the moment when this room will be open and there are bones, we are sure, and there could be made a DNA analysis and an age dating, which would give us more information about the builders of these pyramids. A few days ago appeared a very strange Google Earth picture and a video from the Pacific Ocean, very close to the Easter Island. It showed us one very big tower. It looks like a tower and a smaller tower. So we did a scan over this area, and the result is really sensational, because the big tower is 4,000 meters high. The small tower is 1,400 meters high. And the material we detected is a metal structure. So the big question is, who could have been able to make such a man-made structure 5,400 meters under the sea level, because the top of the big building is 1,400 meters down from the sea level. We found here concrete material with steel, and also these areas are concrete material with steel. Nobody will believe us anyway, so we keep this for us, but I just wanted to show you what we might find even in our days, which was not discovered yet. This is another very strange Google Earth picture from the Pacific Ocean, close to the United States. For me, it looked not naturally, and we did also here a scan over this area, and you can see on the next picture how the structure under the sea level is. These are all so-called anomalies, that means hollow rooms on the bottom of the sea. What I forgot to tell you above about the first picture I showed you about the two towers, this location is nearly exactly on the other side of the earth from the Great Pyramid in Giza. Last May, I was invited to a conference in Japan, in Osaka, and they brought me to some places, some megalith places, which I did not know yet. I didn't see until now any picture before. There are many strange stone structures. Some of them are looking like destroyed, a kind of pyramids made out by huge stone blocks. Some of them are so precise, going one in each other, that it looked for me the same like in Sacsayhuaman in Peru, a perfect strong stone structure. And on top of one of these kind of pyramids, there is a stone parabol antenna. It looks exactly like a parabol antenna looking to the sky. And here you see the great-granddaughter of the famous Japanese emperor, Meiji. She was there, she did a meditation, and a group of Shinto priests and shamans did on the same day a very big, it was 14th of May, and they told me that this is a very special day and that these stone structures are being on this evening activated. Here you see another part. This art of artificial building is approximately 25 meters tall. You see that it is definitely not a natural formation, it is man-made. Also here you can see how precise the stones are joining each other. And many of these stone blocks, they have the unknown symbols. And especially on this picture, you can see how perfect the stone blocks are joining one to each other. So definitely for me, this is not a natural structure, or these are not natural structures. These are definitely man-made. Here you can see the ceremony which we did on a 25-meter high kind of pyramid on top with the Japanese Shinto priests and shamans. They prepared it like the Shinto priests did all these ceremonies. And here in the center, they were putting the skull. I tell you the story of the skull later on. Then I got an information from Manuel Palacios. He is a researcher in Ecuador. He found in the Yanganatis, this is a very dangerous mountain and jungle area in Ecuador. It is very famous because every year there are expeditions going into the Yanganati because there are documents, very old documents, saying that there should be the famous gold treasure of the last Inca, Atahualpa. And many of these expeditions, they have sometimes dead people, so you can see that this area is really very dangerous. But what did they found there? They found a stone formation which has the form like a pyramid. You see here Manuel Palacios sitting on one of these platforms. It is going down in the same scale like a pyramid. The Ecuadorian government sent a few months ago a delegation of archaeologists there, and the result, after checking it one day, the result was that this is a natural formation. You see the pictures here, you can see the whole one side. One block is talking to the other one precisely. So Manuel Palacios called me by Skype and he asked me, could you be so kind and ask your friend if he can do us a scan over this area, because he was quite sure that this is not a natural formation. So we did a scan over this area, and it was not one pyramid. There are three pyramids connected with a huge underground tunnel, and there are also several cross-form tunnels in the very close area. So if these are pyramids, and I cannot say if they have definitely the form of a pyramid, but we could find out with our scan that there are rooms inside. So it is definitely a man-made structure. And not only one, but three of them connected with a huge underground tunnel. So the first question is, the Incas did not like the jungle. They preferred more the mountain area or deeper area. So definitely these structures are not made by the Incas. But which civilization did it? This is now the big question. And there are legends in South America that there existed long, long time ago a kingdom which was called Akakor. And Tiwanaku would have been one of the capital cities. Then we moved to Ecuador. You can see here the tunnel entrance in an area which is called La Mana. It is a small town in the south of Ecuador. And in this area, Engineer Sotomayor, an Ecuadorian engineer, was working for a British gold mining company. And while they were digging, they found a tunnel entrance. And in this tunnel entrance, they found over 300 artifacts which do not fit any known pre-Columbian culture. And I will show you now some of the most interesting artifacts he found there. One intriguing artifact is this. We called him the World Stone Map. It's a very heavy, 350 kilogram heavy quartz stone, granite quartz stone. And there is one natural quartz line here, and all the other lines are engravings. And you can see here North America, South America, one island in the Atlantic Ocean, which does not exist in our days, and on the other side of the stone here, you see Italy, Greek. Here, approximately in the area of Middle East, there is an eye inlay, and the natural quartz line is combining and going around this world map stone. You see here a close-up, here Italy, Greek, Mediterranean, and an eye inlay. And here you can see Saudi Arabia, India, India bigger than in our days, and you know after the big tsunami 2004, the archaeologists found some sunken or hidden cities or villages under the sea level around India. That means that India in the past was definitely bigger than in our days. And in the Pacific Ocean here, you have in this area all the Japanese islands and Taiwan. But from the northeast Japanese islands until far after Taiwan, there must have been once a continent. And Professor Masaaki Kimura, the undersea geologist from Japan, who did all the researches on the man-made structure Yonaguni, a very, very big man-made structure, 25 meters under the sea level in Yonaguni, the southeast Japanese island. He wrote a book about the sunken continent Mu, and he explained upon his researches that there must have been a continent like engraved on this world stone map. Here you see a close-up of this eye inlay, and this is the reverse side, and you see here the natural quartz line is passing the Atlantic Ocean, is passing Venezuela, and ending up here on a place where today is the Bay of Guayaquil. There is an inlay, and then an inlay going up here, and here you have another inlay, and this is exactly the place where all these strange artifacts were found. So, if we have continents which do not exist, like Atlantis and part of the unknown or sunken continent Mu, this world stone map must be at least older than 10,000, 12,000 years. And we have again here the approval that legends, including a big percentage of reality. But the next question would be, who would have been able to make such a precise world map in stone, approximately 10, 12,000 years, or maybe even older? One of the most interesting artifacts found here is a pyramid with an eye inlay here, and 13 steps. It looks exactly like the pyramid with a shining eye on the $1. And when I showed this pyramid in some of my conferences, and they were showing it on YouTube, I got reports saying that be careful, this man is an Illuminati because he always shows the eye of the Illuminati. But be sure, I am not an Illuminati, not a Freemason, not anything. And this pyramid and all the other artifacts are definitely much, much older. They have nothing to do with Illuminatis, but what they do have is a very, very big image and power. That's why many civilizations in the past were using the pyramid with the eye. When you put this pyramid and also some following artifacts under ultraviolet light or black light, the inlay works are shining very, very brightly, especially here, the eye. This is the natural color, and this is the color when you put ultraviolet light on it. And also very strange is the inlay work they did on the bottom of the pyramid. You see here, in little gold plates, the inlay of the Orion constellation, and here an unknown writing. The same unknown writing we found on stones in Ecuador, in Colombia, in United States, in France, in Calabria, Italy, in Malta, in Turkmenistan, and even in Australia. That means there must have been in the past a global civilization or at least global contact. But if you take, for example, the Bible, there is written until the building of the Tower of Babel, they all spoke one language. Nobody accept these unknown writings in each of the countries I mentioned before, because nobody can translate this writing. But there was one man, Professor Kurt Schildmann, he was the president of the German Linguistic Society, and he was able, he didn't say he translated this language, he said he could decipher this language. And he wrote me that this writing has a similarity, a light similarity with the Easter Island writing and also with the writing from Mohenjo-Daro in today's Pakistan. And he called this writing pre-Sanskrit. And you would not believe, but many of these same writings I could see in Visoko a few days ago when I visited the laboratory with the archaeologist. They found some artifacts, and I'm quite sure that it is the same writing like we found the writing all over the world. And that will be very interesting for further researches for sure. Then this stone shows you how this pyramid should have been holded. You see here the eyes, you see the right arm holding the pyramid, and on top holding the left hand. This stone shows a man sitting, holding the pyramid as it was shown on the picture before. He has a kind of helmet on his head, and here goes, it looks like an antenna which shows up to this symbol. And from his eyes are going rays out, and here you see two bowed persons. Here you have the helmet, which was also together with the artifacts, and you can see that here is missing one part, this part which shows like an antenna. Then another interesting artifact from the same place is this big jade cup with 12 little jade cups. The 12 little jade cups, each one has a different size, and we filled them precisely with water, and we put this water, each little one, into the big in the big one, and it was completely filled. So here on the little cups you have numbers. And if you know the Mayan numbers, you think these are the numbers, but they look like, but every time with a little difference, but they might have a connection even with the Mayan numbers. And on the Big Cup, you have a perfect star installation inlay. And the most interesting for me was we did tests with a magnet. The Big Cup inside is completely magnetical, outside not, except in the center of these three stars, which are showing also a pyramid. And I talked with many geologists and they said this is impossible, because if the Jade Cup includes iron particles, it must be magnetical from both sides. This cup is only inside and only here in the center of the three big stars magnetical. Here you see a close-up and you see a perfect star installation inlay in this Jade Cup, and also the star inlays are shining brightly when you put this artifact under black light or ultraviolet light. Here close-ups of the small cups, and you see the similarity with the Mayan numbers. This Jade plate has the same star constellation inlay like the Big Cup, and the two figurines looking up to the sky. I forgot to tell you the translation of the letters on the pyramid. On the bottom of the pyramid, it says the sun, concerning the translation of Professor Schildmann, it says the sun of the creator comes. Here, a photo under black light. And here we have a very interesting piece. This was the form, this stone had the form of a heart, but is broken here partly. And you can see the changing from light brown to black color. And if you look here, you can see the face with closed eyes, with a nose, with a mouth, with long hair and a beard. So, if I would like to make a sensation, I could have said, now we have a Big Cup and we have 12 little cups. We have one stone which has the heart form, and many of my friends, when they saw first time this picture, they told me it looks exactly like the Shroud of Turin. I'm sure that these artifacts are much, much older than 10,000 years. But is there any connection or not? I don't know, but it is interesting in any case. On the reverse side of this heart stone, you have a spiral inlay and a triangle or a pyramid here. And this stone, the side of the stone, is completely not magnetical. The only magnetical point is exactly here in the center of this little pyramid. Then they also found a head of a cobra, and cobras never existed in South America. And for the official archaeologists in Ecuador, this collection is not original because, for example, cobra never lived in South America. The cobra head has on his on one side 32 lines and one dot. That means the number 33. And on the left side and right side, you have 7 points. So we have here the very important numbers 33 and 7. Here the cobra on the black light, and the text says the cobra head has 33 lines incarved in the Hindu mythology. There are 33 god and goddesses. The 7 circles represent sub-chakras in yoga. So that's what I said, that those artifacts do not have any connection with any known pre-Columbian culture. The oldest pre-Columbian culture is the so-called Valdivia, and it goes back approximately 4,000 to 6,000 years. The Valdivia culture has a very, very great similarity with the oldest Japanese culture, which is called the Jomon culture, and which dates also 4,000 to 6,000 years. So these artifacts should be either older than 6,000 years, or they were brought from Middle East to South America. Here the cobra head under ultraviolet light. This is a big snake made out from jade material, has also inlays, and also these inlays, as you can see here, if you put ultraviolet light on it, are shining very strong. So of course, all the scientists are saying, if these are really old artifacts, nobody had ultraviolet or black light in the past anyway. I always say, who knows? And when I was visiting several times South America, and I met some shamans, they told me if they take some special drugs, they can see things under completely different light. So maybe that's another of the explanations. Then we have another thing which has nothing to do with pre-Columbian culture, the Kundalini. You can see here the energy is going, the sexual energy is going on the back side up to the third eye. Here is the reverse side in form of a snake. Then this is a granite helmet. You can put it on your shoulders, or you can lay down and put your head inside. Also, this has inlay work. And when I presented this piece in Vienna 2001 in the exhibition Unsolved Mysteries, some acupuncture specialists told me that these are exactly the energy points which we have on the back of our head. Here you see the owner now of this collection, Germán Villamar in Ecuador, showing how you could use this stone. This is a spiral, a jade plate with an inlay of a spiral. And when I visited first time 2000 Germán Villamar and I saw all these artifacts, you can imagine how happy I was, and I asked him if he can lend me about 40 of these pieces for the exhibition in Vienna. So he told me, yes, I would like to lend you, but I have to ask Luis Viracocha. Luis Viracocha is the top of the indigenous people in Quito and the around area. So next evening we had to visit him again, and Luis Viracocha came. And when Germán Villamar asked him if he can lend me some of these artifacts, Luis said immediately, no, no way. These artifacts are very spiritual for us, and I do not allow that you give them out of the country. So I was really more than depressed, but I started talking with Luis Viracocha about 1 hour. I was happy that I could speak Spanish. And suddenly, he took a small magnet on a string, and we were three of my friends and myself, and he gave this little magnet on the string to one of my friends, and he said he shot it, the magnet, a little bit in the center, over the center of the spiral. And he did it, and suddenly the magnet started turning in circle form until outside the cup, and then it was turning like a perpetuum mobile. He asked the second and the third of my friend, and then he asked me to do so. So I was holding this magnet over the center, and it did nothing. So I was pushing it, and it didn't move. And I was pushing again, and then I was laughing, and I said, Luis, I don't know, but it doesn't work with me. So he looked at me, and he asked my friends, do it again. The first one did it, it was working. The second, the third, and then he asked me again. And I was putting it again over the plate. This is a photo from this moment, because my friend made a photo, and I was holding it. And I wanted to stop, and Luis said, no, continue. And I was holding it, pushing it, a little bit tricky, but the magnet didn't move. And after a while, he said, okay, I was putting the magnet down. He turned around to Hermann and he told him, Hermann, you can give him the pieces. Why? I don't know. But I was happy, believe me. Another very interesting piece is this jade plate with seven circles, with seven circles in different size and different colors. A few months ago, I got a telephone call from a Russian physicist, numerologist, and mathematician. And Mrs. Svetlana asked me if I could be so kind and send her a high resolution of this photo of this artifact, because she can make the matrix. And she asked me if I would be interested in that she makes my matrix. The only thing she needs is my name and my birthday. And I said, of course, I would be happy if she can do something. And then a few days later, she called me again and she said she was really shocked when she saw my matrix, because she said she did many matrixes for many persons, but she never had such a matrix exactly like these circles, not only the thickness of each circle, also each color was exactly like my matrix. And I asked her, what does that mean? And she said she does not know yet, but she tries to find out. This is another stone from the same collection. You can see here, again, a pyramid with the eye. You see here spirals and many unknown symbols. Another stone with pyramid with the eye and three stars inlay or in carvings, which are exactly the same like the three pyramids on the Giza Plateau. And then many ceramics which definitely look for me like figurines from Asia, but definitely not from South America. This, for example, for me, looks more like Japanese, but not like South American. And this is a very, very interesting ceramic. The work itself is incredible, because the completely ceramic is hollow, even this ring here, and it is one piece. The question is, how did they make this ceramic, because the whole thing is this high approximately. And here you can see long skulls or elongated skulls, as we found many all over the world. Now we change, we go to China. The next few pictures are Chinese pyramids, and you can see that they are also covered with soil, and even the Chinese government was putting trees on it so that the image of pyramids disappears. Question is why they are doing this. This is another pyramid in China, another one here. Here again, one with trees on top. And here is my friend André de Smit, who visited all these pyramids, and he gave me a lot of informations and pictures. And you can see that the government prohibited to going up on the pyramids, but he did it. Here another picture, because he got invited by a light airplane, meaning one pilot. It's a very little airplane, and he could drive over the pyramids, and he made really unbelievable pictures. No questions, these are all definitely man-made pyramids. Here is one model of the biggest one they found until now. And here, these are round pyramids. I got this and the next picture from a Chinese archaeologist, and she found these pyramids in southern Mongolia, in China. And in this area, they found many jade figurines, and they called this civilization Hongshan culture. And the age dating of these pieces is approximately 4,000 years. But you know that jade, the material jade, is very hard to work with it. And to make such wonderful figurines 4,000 years ago, minimum 4,000 years, that I have to say, then it is really a fantastic masterwork. The question is why they are showing many, many very strange figurines. And this is from the same area, but it is a bronze statue. And when I saw this picture, first of all, I thought this is definitely Egyptian. It's Isis, because it looks exactly like Isis. And there is a Korean researcher and several scientists. They did excavations in Korea and in Mongolia and in Manchu. And they found a lot of big jade figurines. Here is a photo of the Isis. This is Mr. Che, the researcher in Korea. And he provided me with a lot of material, photos, explanations about his research. And these following pictures are all jade, pure jade, but always painted black with a color which they could not find out what kind of color they used to make the surface of each figurine black. But for me the most interesting was from the beginning the different symbols, because every of you might have seen on internet or in some television reports the excavations of the Moais in Easter Island, because they found out already many years ago, Tuahayadal found out that many of these Moais are going deep, deep, deep underground. And they are now excavating several of them. And I saw close-up pictures from the backside of these Moais, and there are many unknown symbols, and you would not believe it, many of the symbols are exactly the same like here on these in Asia found jade figurines. And why are they black? So I was wondering why these figurines are black, and I asked my friend, please be so kind, whenever you have time, do me the favor and make a scan over the Easter Islands, over the Easter Island. And what did we find? We found out that always in a certain distance behind a Moai, there is a very, very deep underground grave, because we could see material like bones, which shows us it is a grave. And we also saw that there is gold inside in those graves and also precious stones. But we know that there never was a gold mine or gold digging or precious stone digging on the Easter Island. So the question is, where did the gold come from and where did the precious stone come from? So I was checking all the books from Tuahayadal, and in his first book, after he did the first expedition to the Easter Island, I found at the beginning a wonderful sentence. He was writing, first of all, when I arrived and I had the chance to talk with the oldest people on the Easter Island, they told me that long, long time before us, they buried the kings here on this island. So for me, it is clear that these graves must be very important graves, because otherwise they would not include gold and precious stones. So this is for me another point where I think that the so-called sunken continent Mu definitely existed in the past. And maybe From this continent Mu, the Easter Island was the place where they really buried their kings. Hopefully, one day the archaeologists are believing us and really trying at least opening one of these graves. It would be the most sensational because they will find bones there, and that means with bones they can do age dating, and if they of course might find these, there might be a chance, even the skeletons are very, very old, that they could do a DNA analysis and find out who were those people buried on the Easter Island. Also here you see some of these symbols. Here also, again, always the same strange symbols. But again here we have very strange figurines. Partly human body, but very strange animal heads. Many of these artifacts are connected with the turtle, and you know that in Asia, from ancient time, the turtle was a lucky symbol for long age. And then, if somebody is such a great master, or if many of these persons were such great masters that they could do fantastic jade works, why did they show these strange people with very, very strange face? And all these statues are at least 30, 35, 40 centimeters in size, and definitely jade, but black painted. Here male and female. Again, a different kind of face. This face, for example, looks, and this one could be Chinese or at least Asian. This one could be even Russian, Caucasus. A very similar figurine I found in a private collection in Colombia. And there is one mask with the same, quite the same face in the National Museum of Anthropology in Mexico City. Here you have some of the findings which were not yet black painted. So you can see the fantastic jade pieces. Here again the turtle with a face on it. And the next two one are for me interesting because if you look at the size of the man and you look at the size of the skull he is holding in his hand, there is quite a big difference in size. And one of the researches I'm doing also since several years is the search for giants. And that's why this one was very interesting for me, because if it is an original presentation of a man holding skull from another civilization or other type of human, then he must have had at least the size of 4 meters, but 4 meters is not the highest one. The highest evidence on giants I found in Ecuador, the broken bones of a human with a size of 7.6 meters. And Professor Ernst Muldashev, the Russian eye doctor and researcher, he was traveling many times to Tibet, and one day after getting friend with some monks there, he was allowed to try to go a little bit deeper in one of the so-called Samadhi tunnels. He wrote it in his book, The Third Eye. So, Samadhi tunnels, concerning Professor Ernst Muldashev, in the Samadhi tunnels, there are humans from normal size up to 10 meters, and they are sitting in the lotus seat, and the monks were explaining to him that they are not dead. The bodies of all these humans in the samadhi tunnels have no function, zero function, but they are connected, what they call, with a silver string with the universe, and they could come back to life whenever they would decide. Professor Muldashev is not only one of the most famous eye doctors worldwide, but he is also a member of the Academy of Science in Russia, but people didn't believe him, especially not the science. So when he heard that I have some bones from a 7.6 meter giant from Ecuador, he visited me in Vienna to look at the bones, and he and not only he, also other scientists which helped me and looked at them, especially anatomists, they said it's definitely the same like a human bone. For example, I have a heel bone, I have a nose bone, and I have a so-called os occipitale, which they even compared with normal human bones, and they said it's definitely like human, but it's impossible because it's five times bigger. So if you calculate that the Spanish, and there is an old description from Quiesa de León, he was one of the most famous historians of the conquistadors, and he wrote in one of his reports, today we found several skeletons at the coast of Esmeraldas, that's on the Pacific coast of Ecuador. We found today several skeletons which were five times taller than we. And if you think that the Spanish, the Spaniards around 15th, 16th century had the size of approximately 150, 160 centimeters, and you multiply it with five, we have exactly 7.5 meters. This is the woman from the same type of human. They even knew about sex, of course, otherwise they would not have survived. Then presentation of many animals. Some of them very strange animals, but always also skulls. So to the skulls we are coming in the following pictures. Here again a skull and on top an elephant. When I saw this picture first, I thought this could be from Northern American indigenous tribes. Again here the turtle and this skull. This skull was also in one of the places where the Korean scientists did excavations. And now we have skulls. When I had the exhibition 2001 in Vienna, I was able to present six crystal skulls, and Dr. Rudolf Distelberger, he was the director of the treasure room of the Kunsthistorisches Museum in Vienna, and he was a good friend of mine. He did a check on all six skulls, and he confirmed that all following six skulls, they were definitely handmade. On this skull, it's a quartz, smoked quartz crystal skull. The owner told me that she bought it in Guatemala, and the farmer found it while he was working on his ground. So Dr. Distelberger did not know anything about the finding circumstances, but after long checking this skull, he said they used a very sharp instrument to work the raw form out of one crystal block. Then they used for the carving quartz sand, which must have taken a long, long time. And for polishing, he said, they might have used leather, which must have taken also a long time. But then he said, this skull has a corrosion in this area, which shows him that the skull must have been under the earth at least longer than 500 years. So this is one of the real old crystal skulls. The next one is aquamarine, found in Peru, also handmade. This one is jade, found in Mongolia. And when I started this research and when I was planning the exhibition, I have to tell you, I did it because I was the biggest skeptiker. I didn't believe all these stories, these artifacts, and I was naive, and I thought the easiest thing is you bring all these pieces to Vienna, you give the scientists a chance to do a research on the artifacts to find out if they are old, if they are new, if they are new made or whatsoever. But after many experiences, after many checkings of artifacts, we never found a real fraud or new made artifact. And I, of course, at that time, I didn't really believe in crystal skulls. They can give you information and so on. So one day when I had the exhibition 2004 in November, end of November, a Russian shaman, Nina, for me, one of the greatest shamans on earth, she asked me if it would be possible to go with me through the exhibition after 9 o'clock, after closing, and she can give me some information on some of the artifacts. So she did give me a lot of additional informations, but then when she arrived in front of the crystal skulls, she meditated, and when she came back from meditation, while meditating, she was speaking in a language which I never heard before in my life. Then she was talking in Russian to the translator, and the translator told me. She said, the first information of this skull is for me, and this, his information is, you will find and excavate in the near future many things from the earth, but you have to leave after the excavation the earth in a very good condition. And as I am not an archaeologist, and I had no idea of ever digging some place for artifacts, she was right, because with the new technology of my friend, we are already negotiating with several governments to give them places where they can find unknown archaeological sites. And the second information she gave me was, and it was end of November 2004, the second information was, in a few days, a big wave will kill hundreds of thousands of people, and you all know that on 26th of December 2004, the tsunami in Southeast Asia killed definitely hundred thousands of people. So from that moment on, I had to believe that crystal skulls do have informations. This is lapis lazuli from Brazil. This is rose quartz from Ukraine. And this skull was found from a farmer in Mexico together with 3,000 unbelievable artifacts, which I will show you later on, some of these 3,000 pieces. This skull for me is definitely old, and it's hollow inside, which is very strange because usually the skulls are completely. This skull was found in South Bavaria in a wooden box. The wooden box was in a leather box. On the leather box was a name written, Otto Rahn. Otto Rahn was, before the Second World War, an SS archaeologist, and he was searching for Heinrich Himmler, the Holy Grail and the Ark of the Covenant in Rennes-le-Château and in Mont-Ségur. So this skull was found by Otto Rahn, and the skull was on a transport on the last train leaving Berlin in direction to Praha, but the train never arrived in Praha, and we have the transport list, and on this transport list is definitely written Crystal Skull, owner Heinrich Himmler. So that means this skull is definitely connected with the Knight Templars. And Dr. Distelberger did also a check on this crystal skull. He said he is not that old like the others, but he is also handmade and at least a few hundred years old, but maybe even older. But in any, there is no question that this crystal skull was not belonging to the Knight Templars. This skull you saw before on the picture of the ceremony in Japan, this skull was owned by a young man, and the story, and it's not just the story, it is known that everyone who bought this crystal skull got very big troubles. And the last owner was a young man in United States, and he wanted to get married very soon, but after he bought this skull, 1 month later died his fiancée. So when he met Nassim Haramein, who is a very, very famous physicist living in Hawaii, and he's a good friend of mine, he gave this skull to Nassim Haramein, and he said, I do not want to have to do anything with this skull anymore. Nassim Haramein brought this skull to Germany to a conference 2.5 years ago, and he gave it to me, and he said, you can keep this skull here, and whenever you make an exhibition, you can show this skull in the conference. But I told him immediately, Nassim, I don't want to own this skull, because I know the history. And I said, I keep this skull, but we promise now something. We try to find out where this skull belongs, and we bring it back. And Nassim agreed. So I always say the skull must be also, help me also, because I by myself cannot find out where he belongs to. But I'm quite sure there will be someone who can tell us where he belongs. When I had a presentation in Paris last May,
There was Humbert's Man. Humbert's Man is one of the most famous elders of the Mayans. And when I showed him this skull, first moment he was really big surprised. Then he meditated about 15 minutes, and then he told me, this skull is at least older than 10,000 years, and it is one of the most important skulls on Earth. I brought this skull with me to the conference in Visoko, and if somebody is interested, I will bring him tomorrow to the conference, because many people tell me that this skull has a very, very strong positive energy. I have to say I don't feel energy, I don't know why, but the skull is in my sleeping room. And one day I have the visit of a good friend of mine who is one of the three European grand Zen masters, and he is very sensitive. And he was sitting in my living room, and suddenly he started moving a little bit nervous. I was wondering, and suddenly he said, Klaus, what do you have in your house? I said, what shall I have in my house? He said, you have something with an incredible energy. I said, I have nothing with energy. He said, you must have it. I feel it. So I was thinking, maybe the skull. So I went upstairs to my sleeping room, and I brought the skull out, and he couldn't see me yet. And he said, yes, that's it, I feel it, I feel it. And when I brought the skull down, he moved back and said, wow, this is real energy. And I said, why? He said, do you have this skull in your house? I said, I have it in my sleeping room. He said, I could not sleep 1 second. I don't believe that you have it in the sleeping room. I said, of course, why not? I sleep wonderful, he's watching me. On the surface, on top of the sky, you can see clear on this picture a man, the face here, and the feathers. And that's what, why I called him Quetzalcoatl, the feathered god. And Humboldt's man told me also that the jade in his eyes is exactly the same jade they found in the tomb of Bacchae. So most probably the skull is either from Guatemala or from Mexico, I think. Then we move quickly to Mauritania. I got this picture from an Italian geologist, Professor Pitoni. He gave me this photo because he said he did diamond mining for an Italian company in Sierra Leone. And he always also followed legends and mythology. And they told him that close to the border in Mauritania, that there is a stone formation in granite rock, a lady. And the legend says that the princess did many, many things wrong and God petrified her into a mountain. So now we come to the size, because from top of the head until here, you can see the face, you see the breast and part of the stomach part here. From here to here, this half portrait in granite stone is 140 meters. It would be even difficult for us today to make such a monument in a rock formation in hard granite rock. Here you have a close-up of the face, and he said, "Klaus, I'm a geologist. I could not climb up, but from the place where I saw it, for me it is definitely not natural. It is man-made." And he visited the bottom of this mountain, and he said, concerning the earth's movement there, he thinks this statue is at least 10 to 12,000 years old. In Sierra Leone, while he was diamond mining, he got information about another legend there, that Allah, they are Muslims there, Allah got angry to some of his angels. He petrified them and threw them to the earth. He took the sky, petrified the sky, threw it to the earth, and he petrified the stars and threw them to earth. So we have stars, we have the sky, and we have the petrified angels. And always while they were excavating or mining the diamonds, they found sky blue stones, sky blue stones. And we did material check in Vienna. These stones are definitely not natural, they are man-made. We could analyze the complete material, but the only thing we could not find out was what color did they use to get this really blue, sky blue, blue. So Pitoni, Professor Pitoni, named these stones sky stones. We did material check, and the sky stones include up to 13% of material, which does not exist normally on Earth. They only find it when there was an impact from other stars or particle of stars. So here you see the following pictures. Some of these so-called Nomolis. They call this petrified angels Nomolis. Most of them are made out of granite. And as a geologist, he always took organic material from the finding place. That does not say that it is definitely the real age, but it tells us that at least this is the minimum age of these stones. So the lowest or the youngest one he found in about 2 meter deepness, age dating of organic material 2-3 thousand years. the deeper, the older. Here again a connection to the giants. For me, interesting. This statue is about 50 centimeter high, made out of very heavy granite, and it shows a man riding on an elephant. So if you compare the real size of an elephant with this man on top, this guy must have had at least the size also of about 6-7 meters. But then even stranger statues were found. Half the body of a human and reptile faces. I hope nobody will say when they see these pictures, be careful, Donna must be a reptilian, because he always shows these pictures. And the most interesting one was this one. This one is made out of sandstone, and the organic material test from organic material found around the finding place by Professor Pittoni showed him the age of 17,000 years. The figurine itself is sandstone. It was completely closed. This hole, you can see here the closing stone. This part here was outside, same color like the whole figurine. He told me that he could not see that there was an entrance and a hole already. And here you see that this has the same patina like inside. That means it was not shown to the sunshine. And this metal pole. So I brought this metal pole to the laboratory, and next day the professor called me and she said, "Mr. Donner, I think somebody did a bad joke on you." I said, "Why?" She said, "You know what this perfect metal ball is?" I said, "No." She said, "Chromatical steel. And you know that chromatical steel was found first 1904. So I called Professor Pittoni and I said, "Professor Pittoni, we have a problem now." He said, "Why?" I said, "You know, I did a material check on the metal ball." He said, "Yes, what is it?" I said, "You won't believe it, chromatical steel, and you know that it was found 1904. Then he laughed and he said, "Klaus, I'm a geologist. I don't open a very, very old figurine just because it makes a strange sound. I did a completely from all side X-ray," and he sent me the X-ray. You can see on this one the part of the hole and the metal ball, very clear scene. And more interesting, he told me on this X-ray, he saw that here must be an entrance. So he asked a restaurator to open him exactly here, the hole, and inside, like you can see here, was the metal ball. Now we have a problem. 17,000 years old chromatical steel, and chromatical steel was discovered 1904. There is something wrong. Now we move shortly. Oh, we still have time. Now we move to Mexico. A French archaeologist found at the end of the 19th century, deep underground, the first so-called god in Mexico. And the archaeologists don't really know what kind of god this was, but they say it might have been used by, because he is sitting in this style, this part of the body must have been used to put the hearts which they took out from the body on top as a ceremony. Yeah, could be, but I don't think so. Because a farmer, the same man who found the crystal skull I showed you before in Mexico, the same farmer found on his ground in a tunnel 3,000 artifacts. The smallest one this size, the biggest one this size. Out of the 3,000 pieces, 2,500 pieces are stone, and 500 pieces are molded material, like a kind of ceramic. So I got an information, an email, it's approximately 3 years now, an email, top secret, 10 pictures. Top secret from someone I don't know. Maybe someone tries that I open one of the photos and I get a virus and my computer says goodbye. So I was very carefully and I checked one by one through two of different virus killer and I couldn't find a virus. Then I opened the first picture and I watched all 10 and I just thought, this is not real. These are new made, because they were definitely so good that they must have been new. But I'm a polite man. I wrote many thanks to the lady to Mexico City, and I said, it looks very, very interesting, but how you think, why did you send me those photos? Why don't you ask scientists in Mexico or researchers in Mexico? She wrote me back, I was thinking already many years how to present these pieces, but I know that they are so incredible, unbelievable, that I was looking for the right man, and I watched some of your interviews, and I think you are one of the honest ones, and that's why I tried to make a contact with you. I said, okay, but believe me, with 10 photos, even I cannot believe that these pieces are original. So she sent me more and more photos. Altogether, I have now approximately over 1,000 photos. Some of the artifacts have gold inlays and precious stone inlays. And I asked the lady, why this farmer doesn't go public with the pieces? She said, because you can imagine what happens if it is public that he has such pieces in this volume. I'm quite sure that the government will take all the pieces and most probably all, also his land. So she asked me if I can help slowly, slowly to prove for the public that these artifacts are original. And 2.5 years ago in a conference where Nassim Haramein was, when I sent first the first 10 photos to Nassim Haramein, 10 of the most unexplainable for me, because I'm not a physicist, and he was on Skype, and I told him, did you see the photos? He said, no, I open it now, and he opened it, and then he just said, oh my God, oh my God. Then I said, Nassim, just call me Klaus, just to break his impression. So he asked me also if I'm quite sure these artifacts are original. I said, I'm not sure, but we did check. I got 4 pieces for research in Vienna. It looks like they are very old, but still it's not enough approval. And we did a presentation of some of the artifacts in the conference in Saarbrücken. And we asked the public, not making photos and not filming, but someone did a film, and he was putting it on internet, on YouTube, and you can imagine what happened. Even the biggest UFO and alien fans named us liars and crazy, and we show some new made pictures, because as I said before, they are too good to be believable. But I can tell you that 2 of the masks I show you later, these are stone masks with semi-precious stones mosaic on it. And the mosaic, the stones are glued with organic material. And this organic material, we did an age dating test at the university in Tucson, Arizona. The first mask, the age dating of the organic material is 6,800 years plus minus 8,600 years plus minus 100 years, and the second one 12,400 years plus minus 100 years. So this is still not enough approval, final approval. Now we are trying to do do different additional testings, and then we can say these are really very, very old artifacts. But look now by yourself why it's strange. You see one of these Chakmul gods. He is holding something on his breast, but it is definitely not a heart. And look at the one on top here. What is he holding on his breast? For me, it looks like a television or maybe an iPod from the time in past. But interesting is that the Russians are saying, the scientists in Russian are saying that this position would be the best for long space travels. Doesn't that sound interesting? Here, look at him. This is definitely not a heart taken out from a body. And here, this one, you can see even a kind like uniform and helmet. Here again, the form of a so-called Chakmul god. Here another one. Here you can see, it looks like, or could be, a pyramid. These are molded pieces. And here you have some close-ups. And look at this one. Here you have the sun, and the sun eruption, and there is a flying object, there are two other flying objects, and this could be the Earth, because here you have the atmosphere. And interesting, I got these photos definitely 3 years ago, and I'm not sure, was it 1 or 1.5 years ago, on Facebook and on internet, they showed a photograph of the sun with exactly a form, a dark form like here presented. And you will hear tomorrow in the conference from Valery Uvarov, you will hear many things which could be an explanation of this picture here. On this object, you can even see very strange persons looking out of a kind of windows. Here again, looks like a UFO. Oh, pardon. And also a very strange person with very big eyes. Here again, it looks like a UFO. This is the top photograph of the one you saw before. Here you can see the hen, and he is sitting somewhere inside. And here again, planets, flying objects. As I told you, they are too good to be real. Here again, sun eruption and flying objects. Here, I said it looks like a wormhole. Valery said for him it's not real a wormhole, but very interesting in any case. Here you can see flying object, and here a man sitting in the same position as the Chakmul god and raising the left hand. And many of the artifacts you will see now, some of them, they are always raising the left hand. And when I saw these pictures, I said, I am happy that they are raising the left hand, because if they would raise the right hand, I would have a problem in Austria with the police. They call it Wiederbetätigung. But these pieces are definitely old. Here, another one, very, very strange. This is a close-up of the picture I showed you before, and look. If you still find it on the internet, this photo was not shown before I got this photo and this object. And it shows definitely the sun with sun eruptions and this kind of triangle dark in the sun itself. So could it be maybe from past a warning to us, or could it show to us that sun eruption are connected with flying objects? There are many possibilities. Here you have planetarium, but not our system, I don't think so. Here you have a picture of many of the masks, many strange, all different kind of types of masks. And you can see some of stone, some of molded, some of them, but most of them here in stone. How can a farmer who has no money make 3,000 pieces and even some of them with gold and precious stone inlays? I don't believe so. And maybe this December I can fly with one friend researcher to Mexico. We might get the allowance to make a complete documentation of all 3,000 pieces and checking them by ourselves. This is one of the masks we did an age dating. You see, this is a stone mask with a mosaic on top, and this mosaic is glued with an organic material. And we took out part of the gluing material, and as I said before, the age dating is really, really impressive. This is the reverse side of this mask. You see a kind like UFO and someone in a sarcophagus. Interesting, this one, it is stone, this size, has two eye inlays, and the position on many of the pictures, the hand position is exactly like they found the position of the mummies of the pharaohs. This looks like one of the very big Nazca lines in Peru. Another mask, pure stone, but with this incarving on the reverse side. Another mask with this person raising the left hand. You see a kind of comet on his back. This one, a kneeing guy with a helmet looking up to the sky, and it looks like he is holding a child in his arms. This is the reverse side. Very interesting, because for me that looks like a flying object, and this guy is protecting what he is holding, and this looks like a comet. The third eye. Here, a guy with an elongated strange skull and very big eyes, and another one here. This is one of the most interesting ones, because you can clearly see here the mask on his face, also raising the left hand, and the position again like the Chuck Mole. Here another one. Here, a little kind of sarcophagus. You see the inside here and the top. This is the side of this sarcophagus. Here you see two step pyramids. These are some of the figurines, and here you can see that they have gold inlays, the eyes are gold inlays, and some precious stones also here. Oops. This one, very interesting. Also this one. And this is my favorite because here you can see exactly the glass of the helmet and the very big eyes, and also here different planetarium. So you see by yourself that these pieces are too good to be real. But what was the good thing of the unallowed filming and showing on YouTube? Some of the Mexican tribes saw this interview, this video, where Nassim Haramein explained some of these stones, and then they informed me over internet, and they showed me that they have also similar artifacts in their ownership. The indigenous from Oaxaca and other provinces, now they show to the public that they also have since long, long time very similar artifacts. So please believe me, these artifacts are real. I was the one who always said in my conferences, I don't talk about aliens and extraterrestrials as long as I don't have any real approval. I always spoke about unknown civilization, and I still talk about unknown civilizations, as you know on the next pictures, but still I have to change my mind. There is much more what we don't know and what we cannot explain. Now we go shortly to Colombia. A few more minutes. This is one, we called it the genetic disc. It is this size. It is made out of lydite. Lydite is a very hard stone, but the structure is kind like a leaf form, and it breaks very, very easy. We did this and the next artifacts. We did material check in Vienna, and it was definitely lydite. And Dr. Distelberger did check me all these pieces, and after checking he told me, I'm happy that I was here, that I could see that the material is definitely lydite. I cannot tell you who made those, I cannot tell you when they made it, and I cannot tell you how they made it, but the only thing I can tell you, it would not be possible for us with our high technology to make the same artifacts out of the same material. And the most intriguing is that you see here human egg with spermia and without spermia. You see here spermians, and you see here man and child on the reverse side. Here you see a picture. This is a picture a Swedish photographer made with a microscope camera inside a woman, and it shows you the human egg with without spermia. So all these pieces are not accepted as official archaeological findings because they don't fit any known pre-Columbian culture. All these following pieces were found in Colombia, and so they must be for me at least older than 6,000 years. But then the big question, how could somebody know how a spermia or how a human egg with or without spermia looks like? But then again, another big question. I always say, if I find some answer following, I find more questions, always the same. If someone can make such a great art piece, why he shows male, female and child with such strange heads, and here male and female more looking like a frog but not like a human, and here the fetus in different ages? It's a big question. This is another artifact from the same material, this also, and you can see that all these pieces are made on the golden ratio, precise, perfect geometrical design. And each piece fits any hand, a big man's hand or a big woman's hand. Here another artifact, another. This artifact is only this size, And it is so precise, you can put the artifact on this finger, then you can hold it with the two other fingers, and it's so precise you can point, you can find any point exactly because it is like your own fingers. All these pieces are not bigger than this, and can you imagine to make this form today? It's impossible to do it from the same material. Definitely, he said, it's impossible. And again, you can see each piece, the precise, perfect design. And the last two pieces I would like to show you is this one. It shows you the child's head, and there is a danger that it's strangled while the birth. So for me, this instrument is done by a high civilization for a lower civilization, putting already in the handle, showing them for what they should use this instrument to cut when the baby is in danger to be strangled. And the second one, we call it the birth spoon. Why? Because you can see here the baby leaving the vagina, and here the mother's body. And when I had this instrument in Vienna, I asked several doctors to hold it, and they told me that this instrument would be even safer than our today's instrument when there is necessary help for the birth of the baby. Why? Because here you can only put this finger inside, and then you can hold this instrument only with the top of your fingers. That means you cannot use power. You can only use your finger feeling. That really it would be safer than any of our today's instruments. And you can see also here a perfect, precise design. My time, unfortunately, is out. Do I have a few more minutes? Yes? Okay. Then I just would like to show you a few more pictures. This is Santo Ecce-Homo Monastery in Colombia, built 1620. It's in an area very close to the village Villa de Leyva, where you can find today millions of fossils. They even find their dinosaurs' eggs. And this is Professor Jaime Gutierrez, the owner of this collection I showed you before. He brought me there, and we could see that the monks, when they built this monastery, they used even fossils to build the floor and some of the walls. And they found in this area petrified, cultivated fruits and vegetable. For example, here, pineapple. Here you can see that this is the floor of the monastery. You can see that they used fossils to build the floor. Here is an avocado. Here is a close-up of the avocado. Here you have mice, petrified. This is Professor Huertes. Professor Huertes is professor for antique, for archaeological plants, for normal plants, and for anthropology. And he checked all these findings, and he said there is no question. These are petrified fruits and vegetables. In his hand, he holds a banana, and here is a cocoa bean. What does that mean? You find in an area where there are only fossils, you find petrified, cultivated fruits and vegetables. How old these fruits and vegetables are to be petrified? But that's not all they found in this area. Here you see a close-up of the cocoa bean and the banana. This is another fruit. here you have several fruits, all of them found in the same area and petrified. He is holding a part of this bone, also much bigger than our bones, meaning, again, we have a part of a so-called giant or very big person. And they also found in the same area a petrified hand and a petrified foot skeleton of a human. The geological dating of this stone material in this area is between 120 and 140 million years. Here you see a close-up of the petrified hand fingers. And in the same area, they found petrified bones showing an animal which they cannot find out what kind of animal this is. There is no comparison. With big eyes, with a flat skull, but some of them, they even have hand rings. Like this one here. Here you see big eyes, flat skull, tail, and a hand ring. These are all bones and petrified. And here you have the skull of one of these animals shown on the petrified bones. Also, this bone, this skull is petrified, and this carving was definitely done before the petrification. Wonderful in carvings, and also these two animal bones are carved. Here you have a close-up, and here you have the front view of this petrified skull. So the big question is really, now we know that the oldest human civilization, highest civilization, is 6,000 years old. The Bosnian pyramid is at least in an age between 20 and 30,000 years. That means we have already a big missing link. Then we have other artifacts which are showing us that high civilizations lived on Earth even 50,000, 100,000 years, and most probably even million years. And that's what I think, that several times in history of the Earth there was a global catastrophe, not only one time, several times. And we don't know, was it a natural catastrophe or was it done by the civilization at that time? But I think we can learn out of all these old artifacts and old buildings and monuments. We should try to find out why they disappeared, what happened. Maybe we can learn for us, for our future, for our next generations. And I think it's time to change our mind. We should be more open, especially the science, should be more open to all these old artifacts and buildings and monuments, trying to learn why they disappeared and what can we do that we don't get the same position. I think I didn't take too long of your time, and I hope you have something to think about it, and I thank you very, very much.